the common man, now playing a jailer, introduces us to Moore's new home in the Tower of London. He insists that he would let Moore out if he could, but then they would both end up in jail. An envelope falls in front of the jailer, and he takes the letter from it and reads out loud. The letter predicts the convictions of Cromwell, Norfolk, and Cranmer, who is the Archbishop of Canterbury, for high treason, and the executions of Cromwell and Cranmer. The letter reveals that Rich, by contrast, fares very well, living a long life and ultimately becoming Lord Chancellor before dying in his bed. The jailer wishes us the same good luck. Of course, all these events have not yet occurred in the play. Cromwell, Cranmer, and Norfolk have just arrived at the Tower to question Moore. The jailer wakes the now haggard Moore and escorts him to the interrogation, where Cromwell presents Moore with the Act of Succession. The document invalidates the king's first marriage and the Pope's right to sanction it, and the decree also confirms Queen Anne's children as the rightful heirs to the throne. Moore agrees to the second part of the oath but refuses to answer to the first part. All attempts to persuade Moore to change his mind fail. Moore explains that as long as he is silent about why he refuses to swear to the oath, they have no way to be sure he's not holding out just to give them trouble. They can lock him up for life, but they cannot convict him of treason, a death penalty offense. When Norfolk points to the long list of signatories and asks Moore to sign for the sake of fellowship, Moore points out that though they may very well have signed with clear consciences, he cannot do so, and as such would be damned to hell. Norfolk excuses Moore. As Moore leaves, he asks for some more books, but Cromwell, not having realized he had books at all, promises instead to take away the ones he already has. Moore asks to see his family, but Cromwell refuses. After Moore has left, Cromwell approaches the jailer to ask if Moore has said anything about the divorce, the Church of England, or the remarriage. The jailer has not heard anything, but he swears an oath that he will report anything that he hears. When Cromwell promises 50 guineas in exchange for any information, Cranmer adds that the jailer should not just make something up in exchange for the money. In a brief aside, the jailer frets over such a large sum of money, which signals to him that much is at stake and that the great reward could easily turn to a great penalty, perhaps even death. Cromwell instructs Rich to return the following day to remove Moore's books, and he informs Norfolk that the king is getting impatient with them because of Moore's silence. Rich approaches Cromwell to inquire whether he might obtain the now vacant post of the Attorney General for Wales, but Cromwell is preoccupied. Cromwell claims that Moore's silence troubles the king's conscience, but that Moore's execution would trouble his own. He toys with the rack, a torture device, as he contemplates how to get Moore to submit. In this scene, the common man doubts his conduct toward Moore for the first time. Obliged now not only to divulge information about Moore but also to be his jailer, the common man finds that his complicity in Moore's persecution begins to chafe at his conscience. As Matthew, he could still dodge the guilt he felt when Moore confided that Moore would miss Matthew. As the jailer, the common man is conscious of that guilt and excuses his complicity in Moore's persecution by saying, "Better a live rat than a dead lion, better to be alive and guilty than dead and a hero."